Research is primarily related to the phenomenology of active galactic nuclei. In particular, she is interested in probing jet physics in the AGN. Some of the fundamental questions that she has attempted to address in her research are: what factors are responsible for the production and launching of AGN jets, their collimation and their propagation through interstellar and intergalactic medium, for instance, the role played by environment on jet propagation. She has attempted to address these questions with a multi-scale, multi-wavelength observational approach using ground-based telescopes like Very Large Array, the Very Long Baseline Array, and the Giant Meter-Wave Radio Telescope, and space-based telescope like Hubble Space Telescope and Chandra X-ray Observatory. She obtained her BSc from Miranda House College, Delhi University in 1994, and MSc from Delhi University in 1996. Her pre-PhD from Jawaharlal Nehru University in 1997, and PhD from the Indian Institute of Astrophysics and Bangalore University in 2005. After postdoctoral positions at Rochester and Purdue in USA, she joined the faculty of Indian Institute of Astrophysics, Bangalore as a reader in 2012. She moved to NCR in September 2016 and is currently a reader F. May we please welcome with a huge round of applause, Professor Preeti Kar.
Thank you. Okay. I hope I'm not too loud, let me know. Okay, all right. So I'm going to talk about active galactic nuclei, and I work at the National Center for Radio Astrophysics, NCRA. Sorry, this has to be put on. Yes. All right. So have you heard about active galactic nuclei? You have. So these are the energetic centers of a small fraction of galaxies, and shown here are some images. So for example, any normal spiral galaxy looks like this. So there is an increase in the stars as you go towards the center, as you can see in this image. And in an active galactic nucleus, what you see here is a very bright star-like nucleus. So you can make out it's a point source by the diffraction pattern that you see. This is the point spread function of a telescope. Similarly, you see here, there is a galaxy here, and there's like some star-like object superposed on the in the center. So this is an active galactic nucleus. And this was found by Carl Seifert in the 1940s, as I'll show you in the next slide. Another very peculiar thing that he noticed about these galaxies which had star-like nuclei were that they had a very strange spectrum. So for example, a normal optical spectrum, I think Manoj talked a lot about spectra, so I don't need to introduce anything new here. So this is how a galactic spectrum looks like for a normal galaxy. So what you see here are a lot of absorption lines. Right? So all these absorption lines are because of the stars that make that galaxy. On the other hand, if you look at the spectrum of AGN, what you see are emission lines, these very strong emission lines. Okay? So these are the two features, the star-like nucleus and the emission lines. So this is where I give you the definition, the criteria by which these AGN were identified by Carl Seifert in 1943. Star-like nucleus and a peculiar emission line spectrum. So in a normal, and the other thing was that these happen to be all nearby spiral galaxies. So I hope you know the difference between spiral and ellipticals, right? Morphology, they look very different. And all galaxies have around 100 billion stars is what makes a normal galaxy. But the luminosity, the brightness of this AGN can outshine the entire galaxy, all the stars combined, by a factor of 100 or even 1,000. So you can imagine how bright that center is. So if you took, for example, a very short exposure of a galaxy with an AGN, you will just see a star, okay? And that is why the name, I'll come to that as well, the quasi-stellar sources. They are called quasi-stellar because they look like stars, and these are AGN. So here is one of those quasi-stellar objects. So this is a quasar, now we call it a quasar, 3C273. So 3C, the name of these sources are, they come from the surveys where they were first detected. So 3C is a third Cambridge survey. This is a radio survey that was carried out in Cambridge. And this is the number of that object, 3C273. These galaxies are called Seifert galaxies. These galaxies, spiral galaxies which have star-like nuclei, are called Seifert galaxies. These are all very nearby objects. So they were very close by. It was in 1960, so for, 20 years later, Martin Schmidt found out that there was a very strange looking star-like object, which again had a very peculiar emission line spectrum, but somehow the spectrum seemed to be very highly redshifted. So this is the original spectrum from their work. Okay, so this is the spectra in the lab. And here you see these Balmer lines, right? So Balmer lines, I've shown you a hydrogen atom here. So Balmer lines are generated when photons fall from this high energy levels to n is equal to 2 level. So these lines, this is what you see in the lab. And what they saw in 33273 was something like that. It looked like the Balmer series, but it was a very high redshift one, okay? And they couldn't believe what they were seeing, actually. So it looked like a very peculiar star, which had a very strange emission line spectrum. There is a whole story of how quasars are discovered by Martin Schmidt. There was a lot of talking between radio astronomers in Australia and optical astronomers in the US. And then finally, they concluded that this was actually an AGN. And this was, at that point, the highest redshift AGN that was found. So at a redshift of 0.158. And another peculiarity was that, again, this happened much later when Hubble Space Telescope was launched, that they've actually found that the host galaxies of these kind of AGN, like quasars, are not spiral galaxies, but elliptical galaxies. So here, this is an HST image of 33273. So you just see a star. But you also see this emission here. This is a jet. Okay, the jets are what I study. And when you put a coronagraph, so you basically block out the starlight, like Manoj was showing about the planets. When you block out the star, then you see the planet. When you block out the AGN in this case, you see the host galaxy. So the host galaxy now, you can see, is an elliptical galaxy. So these are two things to remember. And this is, again, another image of 33273. Again, the spectrum shown in a different way. So this is the Balmer series. And I don't know if you can see very clearly, but there is, at radio frequencies, when you look at this object, you see this is the center of that galaxy, and then you see a long jet, which you saw a little bit of in the optical. But you see radio is actually going all the way. It connects to the center. So that's where the name comes from. Quasars are quasi-stellar radio sources. So quasars are very important, not just by themselves, but to actually study cosmology. Because they can be found at very high redshifts, you can actually study all the intervening matter between the quasar and ourselves. So this is what's shown in this picture. So suppose you have a quasar here, and you are here observing, then all the hydrogen in this intervening medium will actually start absorbing parts of that spectrum of the quasar. So this is known as a Lyman alpha forest. So these are absorption lines. These absorption lines are happened due to the intervening gas, which could be in galaxies, which could be intergalactic medium, anything. So this happens. So you can actually study each of those intervening systems by studying one quasar. So that's why they're very important. More than just being exotic things in themselves, you can help use quasars to study the galactic makeup of the universe. Okay, you can study proto-galaxies. You can study sources which are when galaxies were just forming as the universe was formed. So that's why quasars are very important. This is another image to show this. So 33273, I already told you about. This redshift is 0.158. When it was found out first time, it was like considered a very high redshift source. But now we know sources at redshift of 5 and 6 even, which is like very, very close to the time when the universe was born, was created. So this is, for example, here you see the absorption lines of the intervening medium is just a little bit. But if you have a higher redshift quasar like this one, 3.62, almost all of it starts getting absorbed, right? This is how you find out. Now, I told you about Seyfert galaxies. You saw the spectra and quasars, okay? There are some differences in these optical spectra of different types of AGN. So lots of the, and they were just discovered, I mean, they were discovered serendipitously. I can't say those words, right? Complex words I can't say. Anyway, they were just discovered by chance, okay? And so a lot of the subclasses of AGN have come from different techniques, so they had different names. It's only now that we are able to make a comprehensive picture of everything. So everything, first people found out a strange kind of object called a BLAC object. This object was very peculiar in the sense it doesn't show any absorption or emission lines, okay? And this is a quasar. This is how the quasar looks like. This is how the Seyfert galaxies look like. So what you can see from here versus this is this power loss slope here, right? This is a flat continuum. This is not a flat continuum. So this is actually telling you something about this quasar. In the Seyfert galaxies, the spectra, there's a difference here also, if you can make out. There are more broad lines, broad meaning you can see this width is larger. as opposed to these lines which are narrow. So this type of an AGN is called type 1 AGN, which has these broad lines and narrow lines. Type 2 AGN has only narrow lines. Okay. So all these different types have been found. This is a normal galaxy. This is another kind of AGN. This is a broad line radio galaxy. They have other spectra, other features, narrow line radio galaxies, etc. So all these different classes have come out because they had very peculiar spectrum. And now we know that all of them are AGN. So this is the zeroth order model of an AGN. This is the cartoon we have. We just have to remember one thing here. So I'll tell you first about these different features, but I just want to tell you that none of this is actually observable. Okay, none of our telescopes have enough resolution to see all these structures. So let me go through the structures. So at the center, there is a supermassive black hole. All massive galaxies have supermassive black holes at the center. So I'll show you an image, a slide about Milky Ways to convince you that there are supermassive black holes. Around this supermassive black hole, there's an accretion disk. So matter is being funneled from the accretion disk onto the supermassive black hole. Then there are these clouds. These are clouds which make up the so-called broad line region. So there are clouds here. If you can see these little gray specks, these are gas clouds moving very, very fast around this black hole accretion disk system. Also, these clouds are very dense. Okay, so we know this, that their velocities are 1,000 to 10,000 kilometers per second. So this is how fast they're moving, and the electron densities are 10 to the 9 per cc. So very dense, very fast clouds. These are the clouds which we think are giving rise to the broad lines that you see in the spectrum. Then you have other clouds which are not so fast and which are not so dense. And these are the narrow line regions. So these are the ones which give you the narrow lines in the spectrum. So you have to remember that all these numbers and the numbers densities of these narrow line clouds are around 10 to the 3 centimeter per cc. These numbers are very robust because they come from spectroscopy. Spectroscopy, the presence of some lines, absence of some lines, gives you a limit on the density of the clouds. So all these numbers are very robust, even though you can't actually see the central region. There is no way you can see the central region. But we know these numbers are very robust, and we think this is what's happening inside an AGN. We also know, apart from these two clouds, there is probably something called a dusty torus-like structure. So it's like a donut, dusty donut kind of structure, which hides this broadline region from certain lines of sight. Okay? And that is how you can explain why some sources have both broad and narrow lines, and some sources have only narrow lines, because if this dusty torus hides the broadline region, then you can't see the broadlines. Okay, so this is how you can unify these different types of, you know, when you looked at these AGN, they had very peculiar spectra, they all seem to be different kinds of sources. But probably most of them are the same sources at different angles to line of sight. Okay, this idea is called unification. So we had lots of subclasses to begin with, but now we think that there are probably just a few subclasses rather than many, many. So you need to invoke this, actually. You need to invoke this dusty torus to explain why some sources have broad lines and narrow lines and some sources don't have broad lines. We also know that some kind of outflows are launched from this black hole accretion disk system. And these are the sources, these are the jets I study. These are jets and collimator structures of plasma. So what is interesting is these are plasma which comprises of charged particles, most likely electrons, though we don't really know the content of these jets. We don't exactly know the composition of these jets. They are definitely light, so they must be electrons. And they are relativistic electrons, so they're moving at speeds close to speed of light. They are moving in regions of high magnetic fields, and they're emitting synchrotron radiation. Okay, this we know. This we are sure about. Based on several predictions of this theory, synchrotron radiation suggests that they should be highly polarized, and they are. It also suggests that the polarization should never be more than 75%, and it never is. It predicts that the spectrum, which I'll show you a little in the next slide, should be having a slope of 0.7, and it is. So we know it's synchrotron emission. The thing I want to stress here is the plasma has electrons which are moving very fast, but the plasma itself, what we call the bulk speed, the plasma itself is also moving at speeds close to speed of light. Because of that, these jets can look they will be showing effects which are completely non-intuitive, as you will see. Okay? So I already told you that type 1 and type 2 are probably just different by orientation. Let's come to the evidence of black hole, supermassive black hole at the center. So the best, of course, best evidence comes from the Milky Way, our own galaxy. You would have probably seen this movie. If you've not, then you should see this movie. Yes?
So the jet are only electrons based plasma, or any information about the nature of the jet plasma?
No. It should be light, because it'll be difficult to accelerate heavy particles, so you can't probably, they can't be probably protons. But it could be electrons, positrons, we don't know. We don't know the content of composition of these jets. And the reason is because you don't see, when you, how do you find composition of a certain piece of gas? If you see emission lines or absorption lines, there is nothing here. So you'll see the spectrum. The spectrum is like featureless.
And any information about the density of the plasma or the jet?
No. So let me just tell more about jets in the next few slides, then you'll see. So this is a picture of the stars around the center of the galaxy, our own galaxy, okay? So these are the names of those stars, S0, etc. The Keck group, the Keck telescope, which the 10-meter telescope at Hawaii, and they have been studying the motions of the stars around the galactic center for the last 20-odd years. And because these stars are close to the galactic center, and because there is a massive black hole in the center, they move extremely fast, very fast. So due to that, we have now, after all these years, actually got the complete orbits of these stars, some of these stars. And this is all infrared. You have to remember, this is not in the optical. This is infrared emission. And the reason why it has to be infrared is this: the galactic center, if you've seen any image of a spiral galaxy edge on, there's a lot of dust. So you will not see an optical light to the galaxy center. So it has to be in the infrared. So these are infrared studies of, and these are actual orbits of stars around the galactic center. And so if you just use the Newton's laws of Kepler's, Newton form of Kepler's third law, you can estimate the black hole, you can estimate the mass around which these stars are moving by this simple relation, V square R by G. V is the speed, you know the speed. We've actually measured all the complete orbits, you know the radius of the orbit, you know the speed, you know how fast, how massive the star is, or how massive the object is around which it's moving. And that turns out to be 4.5 10 to the 6 solar masses. And so in such a tiny space, such a lot of mass, it has to be a black hole. Even if it was like lots of stars, it would have finally collapsed to be a black hole at the end, because it's just too compact and too massive. So end result of that has to be a black hole. For galaxies which are further away, you can't obviously resolve individual stars in the galaxies. You don't see, your telescopes are not good enough to see individual stars. So what you do instead is you look at the gas, okay? So for example, this is an elliptical galaxy called M84, M for Messier, M84. So this is the center of that M84, there's a lot of dust lanes. You put a slit here, this is the center, this, you can see an AGN, a point source here. You put a slit here, you look at the gas motions in this. And what you see is redshifting. As you go towards the center of this galaxy, there's a clear redshift, clear blue shift. So something happens to the gas as it comes close to the center, suddenly increases, just like you saw in the stars. And from this gas motion, we know there has to be a black hole in the center of 3 10 to the 8 solar masses. So much more massive than what we saw in the Milky Way. So Milky Way mass black hole is only 1 million solar masses. These other, some of the other galaxies, like also I will tell you about the EHG results of M87, if you've not heard about them. It's even more massive than even this, so 1 billion solar masses. From this, I want to go to the next point. Here, this is the same galaxy, M84, at different frequencies. The pink thing that you see, this is the radio emission. So just remember always that the radio, because you can't see it, you can put any color for it. Okay, so these are all false color images. You can put your radio to be any color. So yeah, this is the radio emission. The blue thing that you see is X-ray. X-ray emission coming from this galaxy. So let me show you a nicer image of a galaxy. This is Hercules A. Okay, the host galaxy is here. This is an elliptical galaxy. There's actually a small, another dwarf galaxy very close to the center of this elliptical galaxy. This pink emission is radio emission. Okay, and you see how large this is. So this itself is like probably, you know, tens of kiloparsecs in size. This is hundreds of kiloparsecs away. It can be as large as 1 megaparsec away. Megaparsec is the distance between galaxies. Okay, that's a typical distance between galaxies. So a jet can go from one galaxy to touch the other galaxy. Okay, they're that massive, that long. And here, this particular galaxy is very interesting also. So you see the jets, you see very collimated structures, but then you see all kinds of rings and wiggles, which looks like something is happening in the center, that it's shaking the jets in such a way. So that is also very exciting. So the Hercules A that I showed you, it looks very impressive, but actually most of the AGN are not like that. And in fact, 85% of the AGN are not like that. So this was found by this work of Kellerman in the 1980s, when they looked at a particular sample of quasars, and they decided to plot the ratios of the radio flux density, so radio power, by the optical power. When they do this ratio, this is the ratio, R ratio, they found that AGN were in this two hump structure, right? So the ones that I showed you in the previous slide are only this much, 15%. 85% of these sources are having radio flux density much less than the optical. Okay, so they don't have these powerful jets. Most of them are actually, I'll show you in the next slide, they're very tiny jets, not very powerful jets. The powerful jets are rare. And so this is an image to show that. I should tell you, so these kind of sources which have large jets are called radio loud AGN, and sources which don't have large jets are called radio quiet AGN. Even though there is radio emission, there's not like there is no radio emission. It's just that they don't have very large jets. So this is how they would look. This is a spiral galaxy, very nicely. You can see the spiral arms here in the green. This is NGC 1068. The blue emission that you see are jets. And you see how tiny the jets are. They're within the galaxy itself. So this is how most of the AGN are. Only in a small fraction, 50%, 10% of them, you have these large jets. So this is Radio Galaxy 3C31. This is the host galaxy. This is a zoom of the same with the HST. This is the center of the galaxy, and you see the jets. The jets keep going far away, much, much beyond the host galaxy itself. So this is the radio loud AGN. This is the radio quiet AGN. And very interestingly, these are always ellipticals, and these are always spirals. So there is some relation between the host morphology and the radio structure, the large-scale radio structure that you see. OK, so I don't know if you this is not very, very clear, but maybe you'll be able to make out the salient features. So in the sources which are very large, there are two types. Okay. So here, this you can see the difference, right? The difference in the morphology. Difference is that you have a center, you have a jet which opens up, and then it becomes like plume-like. In this case, there is a jet which goes and stops at this point, called a hotspot, and then there is a backflow, and there is a diffuse emission. So these two types of sources was first recognized by Fanaroff and Riley, two people. And so they called FR type 1, FR type 2. These are the more powerful sources. Okay, so they have if you actually get the flux density, yeah, sorry. A backflow of this magnitude.
Yeah.
But why is that surprising?
I mean, how does that backflow even happen?
So this happens. What happens is that when you have this jet starting, some of the plasma just gets left behind right there. So some of the plasma is just getting left as the center of the jet is moving, like that. And then some of them, when it reaches that point where it reaches some equilibrium with the intergalactic medium, then it stops there, and then there's some little bit of backflow. Not all the way, it doesn't come all the way to the center, but there is some backflow here. So some of it is just left behind. Okay, and so interestingly, I can probably go back to this source, and you let me know, what do you think this is? Is it an FR1 or an FR2? So it's neither, actually. See, you don't have any hotspots. You have some edge brightening at the edges. Like you can see some, maybe it's like a hybrid in some sense. This one is like an FR1 jet. This one's like maybe like an FR2 jet, right? Yeah, so people call them hybrid sources. FR1/2. So obviously it's not as simple as just these two, but this is like the broad category. So now let me come to, I'll show you other images of radio sources. They're actually much, much more complex. So these four images, these are actual images, which I have made using radio observations. And so here I want to show FR1, FR2, and then there are these sources. Now this is a BLAC object, and this is a quasar, okay? So I don't know if you can see, guess that maybe if this kind of a source had their jets pointing towards you, you could probably see something like this. And if you have this kind of a source with the jet pointing towards you, would you see something like this? Right? That's the idea. So that is the idea behind what is known as radio loud unification. So unification, there are a lot of unification schemes in AGN, because there are so many different types of sources, you want to somehow make them, you know, fall into one simple picture. And we don't know if this is justified. Maybe this is not justified. Maybe these are very different sources. But broadly, maybe we can try to make it simpler. So that's the unification. FR1s are considered to be the parent population of BLAC objects, and FR2s are considered to be the parent population of radio loud quasars. And here I pointed out that it's not just on the morphology, there are other things you have to consider, like you have to look at the spectrum, you have to see what kind of galaxy environment this source is in, because it could be in a denser environment, in the sense like this could be at the center of a galaxy cluster, maybe this is not in the galaxy, it's at the outskirts of a galaxy cluster, etc. So you see the environment and then decide which two types of sources may be similar. So this is what the radio loud unification scheme is about. FR1s and BLACs are probably the same types of objects at different angles, and so are FR2s and quasars. So this is the image I wanted to show you, that things are not as simple as FR1, FR2. Right? So this is an FR1 jet. This particular source even looks like it has a processing jet. So you can imagine, right? There seems to be like some kind of a wiggling, like something here in both sides. This is an FR2 jet. This is called a double-double radio galaxy. So you see a kind of a core hotspot structure within another core hotspot structure. Okay, this hotspot has kind of faded now a little bit, but this is the brighter one. So this is probably an FR2 galaxy which was on for a while, then stopped. Maybe matter stopped accreting, then started again when it got some more matter. Maybe a galaxy merger happened and it got some more fuel to start again. Then there are sources like this, which are called X-shaped sources. There are sources which are called Z-shaped sources. And all these sources, these processing jets, etc., it's believed that at least some of these may be because they are binary black holes. So how do you get a binary black hole? If each galaxy has a supermassive black hole, and galaxies grow through galaxy mergers, that's a well-documented fact. You see lots of, if you look at any image from a Hubble Space Telescope, whatever, you always see galaxies in different stages of merging. Okay, and so it's very likely that many galaxies have more than one black hole because they ingested the second galaxy. So if you have more than one black hole and they come very, very close to each other, then they can influence the jets of one of them. Suppose one of them has a black hole, the second black hole can come very close and either process it or shake it somehow, change the angle of the orientation of the jet, etc. So this is what we believe is happening in these sources. Supermassive black, binary black holes. So one slide about the GMRT. I hope you know about the GMRT, Giant Meter-Wave Radio Telescope. NCRA operates the GMRT. And so this is a picture of the GMRT, and basically there are 30 antennas. Each of them has 45 meter diameter. And the largest baseline, which is the largest separation between two radio antennas, is around 25 kilometers. And if you know anything about resolution, which is, what is it, lambda by b, right? And that b or d or whatever, that will be the diameter of a telescope. In this case, it will be the baseline. So this is the nice thing about radio interferometry, is that if you increase the baseline, because you're making all these separate telescopes work like a single telescope. So if you increase the baseline, you have a telescope with a higher resolution. This is something that you can do only at radio frequencies, at least right now. Optical frequency, the reason for that being that the wavelengths are long, so you can correlate signals, you can somehow match their phases, etc. So you don't have the technology to do this in optical frequencies. It's just a technology thing. You can do this in radio. So if you increase the baseline, you increase the resolution. So these are the images from GMRT of X-shaped sources, double radio galaxies, some strange twisting radio sources over here, and the frequency coverage. So GMRT is a low frequency radio telescope. So it operates at less than 1 gigahertz. Most of the telescopes like the Very Large Array, VLA, etc., they work at gigahertz frequency. So this is less than a gigahertz. So hundreds of megahertz. All right, so just two slides about the synchrotron emission itself. I told you that the spectrum of synchrotron, so this is the spectrum. Spectrum in this case is like continuum emission. Intensity versus wavelength, intensity versus frequency. Anything, you can choose either of them. If you took flux density at a particular frequency at this point and then another point, they have a power law slope like this. Power law shape like this with a slope called alpha or spectral index. This is how a spectrum of a continuum emission looks like. So when I say the jets, you don't see, you don't know what the composition is. The spectrum is like this. There is no emission line, no absorption line, nothing. It's just this. It's completely featureless. So you don't have any idea about what the content is. Okay, and this alpha and this we know is produced by a set of electrons which have a power law distribution in energies. So this spectrum, synchrotron spectrum, comes from charged particles which already have a power law distribution. So power law distribution now we believe is because of the first order Fermi acceleration mechanism, etc. So we don't have to go into that. But there is an expected slope for that, which is 0.7. Alpha should be around 0.7, and that's what actually is observed. There is another point here to note, which is this: after some power law, it suddenly becomes a steeper power law. And that is because the electron's radiated frequency is proportional to the energy, and the rate of loss of energy is proportional to E square. So the more energetic the electrons, the quicker they lose energy. So that's why you have this sharp drop. The other side of this spectrum is the self-absorbed part, which also has a characteristic slope. So I'll show you this one here. So this is a cartoon to show synchrotron emission, synchrotron radiation. You have electrons moving around field lines. This is highly polarized light. And this is the spectrum again. And this region where it goes from this power law to this side with a different spectral index, this is the region of where the optical depth of the medium changes from optically thin to optically thick. Okay, so do you understand optical thickness? So when you say photons, some region is optically thick for some photons, it means that the photons cannot go through that medium. They will get scattered and stay within. They'll be lost. So that's optically thick medium. Okay, so for that, a tau, basically optically tau has to be greater or equal to 1. That's how you define optical thickness. So this is the optically thick part of the spectrum. This is the optically thin part of the spectrum. All right, and this is to show that frequency of radiation, synchrotron radiation, this is cyclotron radiation, is proportional to the frequency of gyration. So electrons are gyrating around magnetic field lines. The frequency of the photons that are emitted are related to the gyration radius. Okay, so this is how this is the frequency of gyration, which is magnetic field, charge of the electron, 2 pi mass of the electron. When you have relativistic electrons, you multiply that by Lorentz factor square. This is exactly what you get. A Lorentz factor is 1 over square root of minus 1 by beta square. Beta is V by C. These are standard physics relations, right? Another emission which becomes important in radio when you study these AGN at radio frequencies is free emission. This is another synchrotron radiation and free emission. Just remember these two things. Free emission is also called as Bremsstrahlung radiation. When you have electrons freely moving around ions, fields of ions, they emit radiation, which is Bremsstrahlung or free. This also has a characteristic spectrum. The slope of this optically thin part is minus 0.1. I told you the previous one, synchrotron is it should be probably a one in the convention that I used here. I said 0.7, so that in that same sense it should be 0.1. And this optically thick part, it should be plus 2. So there are, if you just look at this continuum radiation at multiple frequencies, you get the spectrum, then you know what emission this is. Is it synchrotron emission or is it free emission? So let me just show you a result which came last year, where these authors found what looked like free emission. So this is a, I haven't given the name of the source. Cygnus A is a very, very well-known radio loud AGN with very large jets, one of the best studied radio loud AGN. And so this, these are the two jets. This is the center of Cygnus A at these frequencies, gigahertz frequencies. So you see this jet, but you see suddenly something very strange, something perpendicular to it. Okay? And this spectrum of this is telling you that this is free emission. So these authors claim that for the first time they have detected torus emission, because the size of the structure is exactly what you expect from the torus, the dusty torus. The size of this region is around 300 to 500 parsecs. So this is the first claim that they actually detect torus emission at radio frequencies, free emission from the torus. So this came just last year. This is another image from the same result, showing these gas clouds around the accretion disk black hole jet system. This is what is giving that free emission. All right. Coming to, so AGN, of course, I told you a lot about radio, but they also, the other very intriguing thing about AGN is that they actually, whichever light you're looking at, whether you look at, whether an X-ray telescope looks at an AGN, whether a gamma ray telescope looks at an AGN, you always have emission. Okay, that's what makes it even more exciting. As opposed to stars. Your stars have black body spectra, right? So you the peak of that black body spectrum is decided by the temperature, and you just have a very narrow range of frequencies from which can be detected for a given star. AGN detect are emitting photons of all possible energies. Okay? So now, so this came as a surprise actually. So in, do you know about the Chandra telescope? Chandra X-ray observatory. So Chandra X-ray Observatory in 1999, when it was just launched, it opened its shutter to look at a particular AGN, a quasar, to calibrate its instruments. It wanted to use it like a point source, right? You use your point sources to kind of calibrate your instrument, to look at the point spread function of your telescope, etc. So they just wanted to do some calibration of this. And when they looked at this, what they thought would be a point source, this is what it looked like. It was a point source with a jet. So this was the first time they found that there were actually, these jets are emitting in the X-rays. And this was a 100 kiloparsec scale jet in the X-rays. Now this is very exciting. It has a high redshift, 0.654. Can you tell me why this could be exciting? I just showed you the synchrotron spectrum. And this is a 100 kiloparsec jet in the X-rays. Yes, but why? Because of that turnover? The higher the energy of the electrons, the quicker they fade. So they can't last 100 kiloseconds. This is 100 light years, 100 years, right? So the extent of, if you estimate the lifetime of electrons which will emit X-rays, it should be 10 years. And this is 100 kiloparsecs in extent. So this is already a mystery. It was very strange to find, first of all, your point source was not a point source. It had a jet, one-sided jet. That's another interesting thing. And it's very long. So something strange is happening here. It can't be just synchrotron emission. And when Chandra finally found this one source, then they looked at other sources and they found lots of X-ray jets.
Can you please repeat the previous
time? Sure.
Yes. Please repeat what you said.
The electron lifetime. You can estimate the electron lifetime based on the magnetic field strength. So you assume like some kind of magnetic field. In that particular magnetic field, how long should the electron last and give you synchrotron radiation?
So you are saying electrons of the plasma jet?
Yes. They're not supposed to emit X-ray photons for more than 10 years once they accelerated. But this is 100 kiloparsecs in extent. So they have lasted that long. So how did they last that long is the mystery. They shouldn't be lasting that long. They should not go till 100 kiloparsecs. So something is keeping those electrons always energetic to large scales. Something is in situ accelerating it. See, when you are imagining that everything is launched from the black hole, that is where they're most energetic. Then they should fade. The energy should lose, they should lose energy, and then they should not shine in X-rays. But they are. They are shining in X-rays to much, much larger extents. All right, so then this is another galaxy called Picturae. This is how it looks in the radio. So this is an FR2 source. You have the center of the galaxy, you have two hotspots lobes. You look at this with X, this is the composition, this is the X-ray. Beautiful X-ray jet, hotspot in X-rays, core in X-rays, one-sided. This is the composite of the radio and the X-rays together. So lots of X-ray jets were found. This is another galaxy called Centaurus A. This is a well-known AGN. This pink emission that you see here is X-ray. So you see nice X-ray jets, maybe also just like radio jets, they have something like hotspots, etc. Right? So X-rays. So this slide is too much detail. I just want to say that from the radio, we know a synchrotron emission based on very simple things, the power law spectrum, high polarization, the limit of polarization, which should be, theoretically, it should be 75%, and we never detect more than 75%. So we know that it's synchrotron emission, no problem. The X-ray emission, we don't know what it is. But it could be many things. So we don't have to look at these spectra, these plots very closely. But basically, it probably is not synchrotron emission, because synchrotron emission should not have lasted that long. Maybe it's something like the inverse Compton mechanism. So inverse Compton, you know about the Compton mechanism, right? What is it? When the electron-photon interactions, right? You can lose, one of them loses energy, one of them. So this inverse Compton is when these relativistic electrons which are producing your synchrotron photons, they can upscatter those photons to higher energies. They can, those fast electrons can then make those photons gain energy. That's inverse Compton. And inverse Compton over CMB is that the CMB, the cosmic microwave background photons, which are very low energy photons, but these jets which have these fast electrons, they can upscatter those CMB photons to X-rays. So that is another mechanism which seems to work for some of these jets. So we don't know what it is exactly, but it could be some combination of synchrotron, synchrotron self-Compton, inverse Compton, etc. Okay, so now I'm coming to the last part of my talk, which is which leads us then to the Event Horizon Telescope. And so this is a cartoon, obviously, of what we think, how we think jets are formed. We don't know actually how the jets are formed. Let me just tell you that first. So this is an accretion disk. There's a black hole. These white lines are supposed to show magnetic fields. So we believe that there is a spinning black hole. There's a black hole which is spinning fast. And the accretion disk around it is also spinning fast. And somehow these electric, accretion disk and black holes are threaded by magnetic fields. And because of this rotation, this magnetic field gets, magnetic field lines get twisted. And this twisted magnetic field lines somehow then transport plasma from the accretion disk or the black hole. Maybe they even form pair plasma there. We don't know. The exotic physics near the black holes, we don't know. And then these jets are produced. Okay. So this is the idea behind what is a very famous piece of work called Blanford and Znaek mechanism, BZ. We call it BZ77. It was proposed in 1977, where they suggested that you can extract energy as well as angular momentum from a spinning black hole. So you have black hole, supermassive black hole has to be spinning, and the spin energy can be taken to produce, to power these jets, because these jets are so large. There's no other way to explain why, how they are created, how they are formed, and how do they stay collimated for such long extents. So this is one of the favorite mechanisms of jet production, BZ 1977. Here the power extracted is proportional to the magnetic field strength square and angular velocity square. Okay. Now, to see if this actually works, what you need to do is actually go very close to the black hole. And to see these magnetic field lines, you have to do polarization sensitive studies. Right? So polarization, yeah. Of the black hole. Black hole accretion disk system. That is what's being used by the for the jet formation. So you have to do, so you then have to do VLBI, very long baseline interferometry. I will talk about that. And it has to be polarization sensitive. That means you need to detect polarization. Only then can you study magnetic fields, right? You remember the cartoon I showed you? You have the magnetic fields, electrons going around that. That's synchrotron radiation. That's polarized because of the magnetic field structures. So to study magnetic field structures, you have to look at polarization emission on VLBI scales. So this brings me to VLBI, very long baseline interferometry, okay? And again, this is only because we're doing radio frequencies, you can, I told you that you can extend your baseline to make a very high resolution telescope. So there is nothing stopping you from actually using telescopes across Earth, make them work together, then it will be a telescope as big as the Earth. Okay, that's the idea. So VLBI. This is different from telescopes like the GMRT. So GMRT is one in one place where each of the antennas are actually connected by optical fibers. VLBI doesn't work like that. VLBI will be, if you use GMRT and then you use the VLA together as a single telescope. That's VLBI. So there is nothing stopping us from, you know, increasing these baselines. And so here, because there is no one place to, you know, there's no optical fiber getting signals from different antennas, you, what you do is, so this is, let's say, shows Earth. These are two telescopes. There's a quasar. The wavefronts are coming, reaching us. They are detected by two separate telescopes very, very far away, several 10,000 kilometers away. And so you record these data on magnetic tapes. Then you ship those. When the recording is done, you have to make sure that they are accurate time-stamped. I mean, because you're going to correlate these signals from two antennas, they have to be the same wavefront. Obviously, otherwise you won't be able to see anything, right? So you have to get the same wavefront. So you have to match their phases in such a way that the same wavefront is captured. To do that, you have to have a very high accuracy clock, like usually a hydrogen maser, at both those stations where you're recording the data. Then you bring them to a common place and play back the tapes, correlate the data. Correlate the data, that's how radio telescopes work. You have one signal, another signal, make them multiply and average them. That is how you get radio data. This is just a VLBI array called the VLBA. So VLBA is one of the arrays which does VLBI. So these are 10 telescopes across the US. They're not connected. They're all in different places. Some of them in Hawaii, some of them in Virgin Islands. They all work together like a VLBI array. There are many other telescopes which do the same. So when you do VLBI, you get very interesting results. So now you're somehow in a regular telescope like the GMRT, your resolution is 1 arc second. Okay, 1 arc second, just remember that. Optical resolutions are around this much, arc second. So you get images which are comparable to the optical images that you see. Now you go to VLBI, you get 1 milli arc second. So now you don't have optical images to compare this with. This is only radio now. Okay, you're getting close to the black hole, but only at radio frequencies. There's nothing else now, no optical telescope, no X-ray telescope, nothing. So only radio. So now this is MET7, Messier 87. This is the well-known jet, one-sided jet lobes. This is an FR1 source. And this structure you have, this has been observed in many, many telescopes, GMRT, VLA, lots of telescopes have observed this. This is the same in with the Hubble Space Telescope. So Hubble Space Telescope also shows this jet in the optical frequencies. So this is a synchrotron radiation in optical frequencies in MET7. Now you look at the center with VLBI. When you look at the center itself is a point source, okay, which means unresolved to your telescope. Point source means that you can't see anything below that, right? When you look at that with VLBI, you see another unresolved structure and a jet. You've now got very high resolution of that center, that point source. The point source then resolves into a point source and a jet. When this happens, all kinds of very interesting physics can be seen, which is completely non-intuitive, because now you're entering the realm of the special theory of relativity. You're now probing these relativistic jets, not the electrons which are making the jets. The jets themselves, the plasma of the jet is moving to close to speeds of light. Okay, so then you have very strange effects. So now, for example, this radio source. First of all, you see here, you have a core, which I said is a point source. You have a one-sided jet. There is no jet on this side, right? There is no emission. You don't see anything. And this is, I also showed you that in MET7. You don't see any counter-jet emission. This doesn't mean there is no counter-jet. There is a counter-jet. If you were in the frame of that source, there are two jets like this. It has to be always two jets. Otherwise, you won't have a stable configuration. So it's going this way and that way. Yeah. I don't think so. This is all very, very local to the center. I'm not aware of that, but I think it's not supposed to have any. This is a very, very local effect. Even the stars don't know about this.
Even the bulbs around the
Even the bulge doesn't know. Yeah, it doesn't know about exactly what's happening in the black hole. There are some relations, there's something, some connections, but that happens because of the so-called AGN feedback. The jets will somehow inform the bulge. But nothing inside knows about the large-scale structure. Okay, so the first thing is that you see one-sided jets. So the result, this is because of what is known as Doppler boosting. So Doppler boosting, I'll show you in the next slide with the relations actually. Doppler boosting will somehow enhance the emission that you see of the jet which is coming towards you. The jet which is towards you will always be brighter than the jet which is going in the opposite direction. And not only brighter, the jet which is going in the opposite direction will be dimmed, actually. So it becomes, you don't see it at all, because it gets so dim that you can't see it. So I'll tell you the relation for that. So that's the first thing. You see one-sided jets. One-sided jet means the jet is moving close to speed of light. That is the first indication. Yeah. No, so it's all over the radio. You go to very low frequencies, you see it, very high frequencies, they're all over the spectrum. And they go in the optical, they go in the x-rays. It's a very, very broad spectrum thing. Okay, so now, the second thing, one-sided jet. Second thing you notice is, now this is that same jet of M87 at a different angle. They just rotated this jet. This is that jet, okay? Core jet. This is that same jet. So what you see in these jets are these bright points, right? These are what are called jet knots. They look like just bright, compact features along the jet. We don't know if these are shocks in the jet or they're actually packets of plasma, something. We don't know exactly what it is. But what we do know is when you observe this for many years, so here this is the same image, you see this point source, whatever that compact point, is moving away from the center, right? So this is over, 94 to 98. 4 years, something has moved away. You can actually see plasma motion. When you measure the speed of this, it turns out to be greater than the speed of light by a factor of 6. This is what is known as superluminal motion. Something going faster than the speed of light. Obviously, this is not actually happening, okay, because nothing can go faster than the speed of light. So this is superluminal motion in the sense of it looks like it's going faster than the speed of light. But I'll show you in the next slide that actually just it's kind of an optical effect. If you have a very fast jet with beta, that is V by C, so velocity of the jet is 0.99 times the speed of light, not equal to C yet, less than C. But if its orientation is small, let's say theta is equal to 10 degrees, that means the jet is pointing not at 0 degrees but like this, little bit like this, then it looks like this plasma motion is happening at 6.9 times speed of light. Okay, so let me just go to these equations now. So these are the special effects, non-intuitive effects, which happen because the jets are moving very fast. So this I already told you about Doppler boosting. The intrinsic luminosity of the jet, like what it is when you are in the jet frame. Suppose you're in the jet frame, you measure so much flux, so much luminosity. What you observe is much larger by Doppler times 3 plus alpha. The Doppler factor is 1 over gamma 1 minus beta cos theta. Gamma is 1 over 1 minus beta square. So this is the special theory of relativity that's coming in. And theta is the orientation of the jet with respect to line of sight. Okay. This is the jet to counterjet intensity or brightness ratio. 1 plus beta cos theta, 1 minus beta cos theta, 3 plus alpha. This is why you always get one-sided jets when you have any sensible beta and a theta. You will get one-sided jets. Apparent speeds. The apparent speed is actual speed, beta sine theta, 1 minus beta cos theta. You just put in this angle, beta is equal to 0.99, theta is equal to 10 degrees, you will get beta apparent equal to 6.9. So this is just that. And these are plots to show this, these relations. Angle, Doppler factor. As the angle gets small, the Doppler factor suddenly increases. So if you have a jet which is close to your line of sight, it becomes incredibly bright. Okay, it shoots up in brightness. Similarly, if you have viewing angle, beta apparent. When you come close to small angles, the beta apparent speeds up. So it becomes 15 times the speed of light. Okay, so this is the relation. These can be found in Rybicki-Lightman and several other places. So now I'm coming to the last part of my talk about VLBI polarization. This is what we want to do, actually. If you want to really study jets, you have to do VLBI close to the black hole in polarized light. So this now is another one-sided jet from VLBI. These contour images are just showing the jet. The color here, this is polarized, they have detected polarized emission all along this jet. The colored here is what is known as a rotation measure. Have you heard about Faraday rotation? You must have. It's a basic physics thing. Faraday rotation? Exactly. So when you have linearly polarized light, and when it passes through some magneto-ionized medium, the plane of polarization will shift. That's Faraday rotation. So the rotation measure is kind of an indicator of how much Faraday rotation is happening. And so I've given here rotation measure Rm. Chi is the polarization plane of polarization, the plane of electric polarization, plane of the electric radiation, is equal to proportional to lambda square rotation measure. Rotation measure is nothing but, these are some constants, electron density in that medium, magnetic field strength in that medium along the path, along your path, and the path length. That is what decides how much rotation will happen. So that's a rotation measure. So without going into this, this is basically just plotting that chi and lambda square. When you plot lambda square chi, that slope is a rotation measure. This comes from this relation. What people have found is that when they look at this rotation measure, and if you take a cut across the jet, rotation measure seems to change across the jet. So, for example, if you have, this is the showing the torus now with that magnetic field, which I showed you as a cartoon initially, right? You have a rotating accretion disk structure, and you have magnetic field lines which are twisted like that. Suppose you have, because of this twisting field lines, you have magnetic field lines like this. So here the magnetic field line is coming towards you, this is how it's going away. Suppose you take a cut here, if the electron density is the same, what must have changed is the magnetic field. Rotation measure gradient, which you measure across the jet, if electron density is the same, it must be the magnetic field. This is a vector which is changing. That means if you detect a rotation gradient across the jet, the field is helical. It's coming towards you in one direction, going away from you in the other direction. That's why you see a gradient in the rotation measure. Okay, so when you see this, you know you are actually finding out that the magnetic field structure in your jet is helical. This is just to show that, tell you that you can use polarization to find out the magnetic field structure in your jets. Okay. Because at radio frequencies, you can increase, keep increasing your baseline and increasing the resolution, you can do what is known as space VLBI. Like, what is stopping you from going away from Earth? So this has been done. And you have a telescope on, or several telescopes on Earth. You have a space telescope, a dish. The first dish, first space VLBI mission was launched by the Japanese. It was an 8-meter telescope in space, and this was between 1997 to 2003. It worked at certain frequencies. The resolution that you could, now you're going to less than a milli arc second, because you can go away, you increase your baseline, go far away from your Earth. So that baseline is now your resolution. So you're now increasing your resolution. The newest mission, which was launched in 2011, is called Radio Astron. This is from the Japanese and Russian astronomers. This is a 10-meter dish. The baseline now is 350,000 kilometers. So this is a telescope around Earth. Remember the baseline for JMRT is 25 kilometers. Okay, so that's 1 arc second. When you go to 350,000 kilometers, then you get a resolution of micro arc seconds. So this is now a galaxy, AGN, called Perseus A, at a resolution of 50 micro arc seconds. So now you are going all the way to the black hole, the very center of the black hole. You're now seeing radio emission, 50 microarc. There is no optical telescope which can go X-ray, nothing, only radio. What you see in this result, this came in 2018 in Nature. What you see, this is the center. This is where the black hole is. Okay, you see this jet is no longer a continuous structure. There is something called edge brightening. It almost looks like empty in the center. There are some edges of the jet are bright. This is called edge brightening, and the center looks empty. And this is actually seen in all, or rather many jets, like I'll show you in M87. Edges are brighter. And in fact, this is also another indication that the magnetic field line could be helical. There is a way to get edge brightening if you have a helical magnetic field structure. The kink instability. No, kink instability will happen, that will just, twist jets. and brake jets and all. No, not the edge brightening. That's not the King instability. So now with radio astron, you got went to 30 microarcseconds, and when they looked at this jet, what they found was there is no longer a point source in the center. The point source gets resolved in this direction. That means they're now getting the base of that jet, which is not a point source. So it's not coming from the black hole. That is 250 Schwarzschild radii, gravitation radii of the black hole. Do you know what gravitation radii, Schwarzschild radii, you know, right? 2gm by c square. So now 250 times Schwarzschild radius, this width of this, whatever the so-called core, which means that the jet is actually coming from the accretion disk. The jet is actually being launched from the accretion disk. You're not having a point source anymore. The point source has now got expanded. So these are results that you get when you do space field BI. So now final thing, the Event Horizon Telescope. So you know that resolution is lambda by d. So we have increased lambda. No, sorry, we've increased d, the baseline, by going to space. If you want to go even further, then you decrease your lambda. Right? So then you go to millimeter waves. Instead of going at megahertz and megahertz emission, now you go to 100 gigahertz emission. Go to very high frequencies. Then you again improve your resolution. And that's exactly what the Event Horizon Telescope did. So Event Horizon Telescope is, at least when the observations came out, these were the set of 8 antennas which took part in it. Now they have actually expanded this. So these are telescopes which work at millimeter wavelengths. Okay, and the way you make out from these telescopes, can you, from the way these telescopes look, can you tell what frequency it's measuring? So you see the GMRT dishes are like meshes. These are filled, these are solid surfaces. And that's because they can only, the shorter your wavelength, the more perfect the surface is to scatter it. Otherwise, it will not get focused to your. So it has to be tight, like, that's why you need optical surfaces have to be very, very shiny, right? So when you go to shorter wavelengths, you have to get shiny telescopes, filled dishes. And that's what's happening here. The imperfections have to be less than 1/10 of your lambda. So when you go to smaller lambda, your dishes have to be perfectly smooth. So you see from these dishes, these filled dishes, that they are measuring millimeter waves. So these are millimeter waves. This, you see the shiny telescope here. So these telescopes observed together, and actually the main target of their study was the Milky Way black hole. And they did not announce till the very, actually they did not announce at all beforehand that they were not going to, they just said they're going to show the results of the Milky Way black hole, but ended up showing results for MBT7, because this happened to be an easier system to study. So the data were acquired in 2017, and the press release happened in 2019, last year. Observations were at 230 gigahertz, so less than 50 microarcseconds resolution. Okay, so this image, of course, you've already seen, I'm sure. So this is now the image of the black hole in MBT7. And so a couple of things to note. So this is the cartoon showing what is probably happening. You have the black hole, accretion disk. And because of gravity, the light from the back part of the accretion disk is actually getting bent into your line of sight. So you get some kind of spherical structure like this. So this is emission from the back of the accretion disk, behind the black hole. And the fact that this structure is much brightened is just telling you this is Doppler boosted. So this is moving at close to speeds of light, and it's coming towards you. So Doppler boosting, gravitational effects to bend light is giving you this image. So now, because of the technique of VLBI, we are now going from M87, which you just saw the image of. You go higher resolution, you get this. You already start seeing the jet brightening at these. This is VLBA at 43 gigahertz. Go even higher resolution, GMVA, global millimeter VLBI array, 86 gigahertz. Again, you see the edge brightening. You go even further to EHT at 230 gigahertz, you see the black hole. Okay, so EHT has now actually been looking at several bright AGN, and so we should be seeing images of other black holes very soon. And polarization data are being looked at. So now we are actually now trying to see you're actually going to see how the magnetic field looks like near the black hole. the cartoon that I showed you earlier, where we think it's the Blanford-Naik mechanism, now we can actually check that. And so I just want to stop here saying we have really exciting times ahead, and I hope that you get interested in millimeter VLBI observations. Okay, I'll stop here. Observational?
Pattern. Is there any sort of pattern during the galactic mergers in the jet evolution?
Consequence that you see when you have.
Okay. So some of it I think I already mentioned, right? When you see jets, ideally when you have a stable system, you should have bipolar jets in exactly, you know, vertical above and below the disk. Many times you see these jets are not exactly perpendicular. Something seems to have shifted their angle. Sometimes, there is a sudden change. Sometimes you just have what looks like a wriggling motion. So we believe all of these have had something to do with galaxy mergers. Sometimes you don't see when you look at the optical galaxy, you don't see any obvious signatures of galaxy mergers. So then we believe that this merger happened probably many, many, you know, millions of years ago. And somehow all the effects are now very close to the black hole that are affecting the black hole jet. See, the black hole jet should get affected only when the second, whatever massive thing, is very close to it.
And I'm following this. Is there some effect because of the stellar mass black holes inside the galaxy in falling inside the supermassive black hole?
Okay. So, that's true. So, when you have a smaller galaxy being ingested into this larger galaxy, it immediately creates fuel for accretion. So a lot of times it happens when you have this galaxy, which like the double radio galaxies, for example, there are something, these are called restarted AGN. We believe that the restarting is probably linked to some galactic merger as well. So that you get fuel through these smaller galaxy mergers. And then you also may, if the galaxy is large, then you will have another black hole. And that will have some effects as well.
Yeah, thank you for this wonderful talk. So I have some questions like, what is the strength of magnetic field? Is there information of the twisted magnetic field strength? And if the plasma is totally magnetized or unmagnetized?
So the answer to that is we don't have estimates of magnetic field strengths.
Okay.
See, how do you get magnetic field strengths? You get magnetic fields, for example, one way to get magnetic field strengths is from Zeeman line splitting. Mm-hmm. We don't have lines. We can't observe Zeeman splitting. All you see is this power law spectrum. You don't see emission lines, you don't see absorption lines, it's just continuum emission like that. So you don't have any indication of neither the elements nor the magnetic field strength. So we have, okay, let me just tell you what we do since we don't have this information. We estimate what is known as the equipartition magnetic field, which is not really, we don't know what it is. We don't know what the actual magnetic field strength is. But we make an assumption. We say in this plasma, the energy which is in the particles, whatever particles it is, electrons, positrons, protons, whatever, is equal to the energy in the magnetic fields. So we equate the magnetic field energy density to the particle field energy density. We make this assumption. And then we, from the synchrotron photons, which kind of gives you the particle energy density, because these are the ones which are producing synchrotron photons, you can then estimate magnetic fields. So this assumption is called equipartition or minimum energy condition. And from there, you get magnetic fields, which are called equipartition magnetic fields. So we don't know if these are actual fields. But this is sometimes we need this information to understand. Like lifetimes, when I said lifetimes of electrons in some magnetic field, that magnetic field that I mentioned is the equipartition magnetic field.
Yeah, one more question.
Yeah.
So the accretion disk that is around the black hole, are they also giving synchrotron radiation?
That's an excellent question. We don't know. When we see the core that you see in synchrotron jets, that is radio emission from, it could be the accretion disk, it could be just the base of the jet. We haven't gone that far close to see the accretion disk itself, except in M87. And M87 is not polarization stuff yet. Once we see polarization, then we will be actually be able to say that this is the accretion. Actually, even in M87, we don't know if it's this structure that you see is only the accretion disk, or this could just be the jet and the counter jet emission also.
But usually they can
The induction, if there are fast moving charged particles, you have magnetic fields, you should have a synchrotron emission. But how powerful is it compared to the jets themselves? We don't know.
More from the instrumentation and computational point of view, you just mentioned that VLBI stuff. So I'm having some difficulties in modeling the atmospheric causes in that particular VLBI data.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can elaborate on how usually the atmospheric noise and then the typical noise introduced by the receivers is removed from the signals.
Sure. Okay. So radio interferometry observations mostly at megahertz, gigahertz frequency are not very badly affected by, for example, the ionosphere in the atmosphere. This happens much more at either very low frequencies or very high frequencies, atmosphere comes in. But there is still always atmospheric effects. So what you do is you observe your, so the way the technique is like this, you observe your target, whatever your galaxy is, then you observe another point source, another radio point source, which is called a calibrator. It has to be a point source. It will probably be a quasar far away. Okay, so then you look at that target, your target, go to the point source, come back to your target, go to the point source. The assumption is that this light from these two sources is coming from the same patch of atmosphere. And since it's a point source, it should have a zero phase. A point source has a zero phase. It only has amplitude. So any phase difference that you see in these two point sources is because of the atmosphere. That is how we decide what is atmosphere, the effect of the atmosphere. So this technique is used between source and target and calibrator.
Okay, so actually I read the paper about that reconstruction EHT paper.
Yes.
They have mentioned that they have used some kind of this information in the signal itself by some cross multiplication, cross division, which
yes.
they haven't clearly mentioned what
yes.
it is.
Yes. So I think this must be definitely playing a role. But gigahertz, when you go to millimeter, this atmospheric effects become much more important because of the water vapor and all that. That affects your millimeter waves. So, but the technique has to be probably similar. It'll be probably observing your target and a calibrator, which has to be very close. It has to be a point source very close to your target.
So these are kind of, these, we are talking about the radiations, right? Maybe the radio or anything. So how does gravitational lensing affect all of these observations?
Gravitational lensing?
Yes.
Gravitational lensing. Okay. So there has to be, for example, the EHT results. I haven't really looked into this, but the EHT results, for example, there has to be some effects of gravitational lensing here. I don't think they are able to extract that from whatever images they're getting. I think all those effects will probably get very important closer to the black holes, I mean, the kind of effects that you're talking about. And so far, we have not really had to worry, because we've not really gone that close to the black hole itself. And there are other kinds of gravitational effects which happen, for example, suppose you have a quasar whose light is coming through a galaxy cluster. Okay, light is coming through the galaxy. So this galaxy cluster can act as a lens. Okay, so then what will happen is that has been seen often, that you see, instead of a point source, you'll see several point sources around that. So from that many radio galaxies, many AGN have been found with multiple images. And then there is some gravitational effects, gravitational lensing effects because of the intervening medium. But there are also effects because of the close to the black hole itself, which we don't know much about.
Yeah, simple question. So what is the dimension of the plasma jet and the radio bursts? So are they same dimension?
Radio?
The electromagnetic bursts and the plasma jet dimension.
What do you mean by bursts?
So you showed in the figures the...
Actually, the knots.
Yeah. Not knots.
Hmm.
So the dimension of the radio burst is pretty large, like kiloparsec length.
Radio jets.
Radio jets.
Yes.
So are the plasma jet dimension is also like that, or is smaller than that?
Okay, I'm not clear about what you mean. So for example, if you look at the VLBI jets, the dimensions of those bright points, the knots that you see, are usually 100 parsec or something in extent. The radio jets themselves can be 100 kiloparsec. So the extents versus maybe the jet components
so
is what I
mean. The structures that is visible,
yeah,
are the only electromagnetic radiations, or the plasma is also there in those structures?
The electromagnetic radiation is due to the plasma.
Okay.
Maybe we should, we can talk.
Yeah.
Last question.
I was wondering if for an individual radio telescope, is there a minimum resolution at which agents become detectable? For example, and at what range would it be ideal or optimal? Somewhere around 6 to 14 gigahertz, would that be an ideal range?
Okay. So the answer to that is every radio telescope will detect an AGN. Okay. So the resolution will decide if it's if you can just see a point source versus do you see a jet and a point source. Right? So you, even a single radio telescope without even interferometry, like the Green Bank telescope, even a single antenna, not the whole array of the GMRT, just a single antenna, will also detect an AGN. The resolution will be so poor that you will just see a point source. More telescopes you have, you'll start seeing details in that point source. So that's it. But everything will detect. Every radio telescope will detect AGN.
I was wondering, so while the galactic mergers are happening, so when the inspiral process is happening, you see jets. And after the merger, and at the point where gravitational wave gets out.
Yes, yes.
So there's a difference in the strength of the jets?
So the jets are not related at all to the, this is all that is, the gravitational waves will happen when you have two black holes which will merge.
That's fine, but yeah. there was this paper which I read somewhere, and we can talk about that, but they say that there's a certain matter which gets trapped in that last parsec, and that has an electromagnetic observational consequence later on. So they were saying that they might have a jet kind of observation at
okay.
the merger point.
I see. So I think there's not much work done for when you say black hole mergers. I think jets are not usually counted so much. I mean, most likely these black hole or binary black holes are happening in systems where there are not very powerful jets. That's first thing. What does happen is when you have two supermassive black holes, when they start coming closer to each other, in fact, to get them closer, they have to throw out all the matter, intervening matter. That is how, this is a three-body interaction that happens. And so these two black holes will start throwing stars out of this, when they come closer. So they will create a space which is actually deficient of stars. That's called the core. So in a galaxy, in the center of the galaxy, you have what is called a core where there are less stars because these two black holes have come closer by throwing stars away. So, but jets, we don't know. I mean, jets, I think we don't talk about jets. It's the stars which are thrown away.
Thank you so much, Preeti. Thank you.